The impact of the coronavirus has been significant in the United Kingdom. COVID-19 has touched the royal family, and British Prime Minister Boris Johnson became the first head of state to contract the virus. The Prime Minister was taken to hospital 2 days ago and has since been moved into intensive care. This comes on the heels of a rare televised address by Queen Elizabeth as she sought to calm and unify the country. Is the UK following the trajectory of Europe's worst hit nations, namely Italy and Spain? What measures have been put in place to mitigate the growth of coronavirus, and are they working? Voice of America correspondent Henry Ridgwell joins us from London to answer these questions. Henry, thank you for joining us.
Great to be with you, Tonya.
So first of all, I'd like to ask, what is the condition of Prime Minister Johnson?
Well, the latest update we had was this morning from his office at 10 Downing Street. They reported that he spent last night in intensive care, having been admitted to that ward last night at about 7 o'clock. The last time we heard from the Prime Minister himself was on Monday morning when he was in a normal ward in hospital, not in intensive care. He wrote on Twitter that he was in good spirits and that he had been taken into hospital purely as a precautionary measure. We understand that his condition deteriorated quite rapidly in the afternoon, and that's why doctors took the decision to move him into intensive care. Now, he's not been put on a ventilator, but he has been given oxygen in intensive care on several occasions. He's just suffering from the classic persistent symptoms of the virus, namely a persistent cough and a high temperature. And doctors are concerned because those conditions have not improved. But we haven't had any further update from the hospital so far today on Tuesday. We understand he is still in intensive care, and we await to hear the latest news later today when the government gives its daily press conference.
Mm-hmm. And so for the coronavirus, or with the coronavirus, how broad is the spread of this disease or this virus in the UK?
Well, we know that the UK is seemingly following a similar trajectory to some of the other worst hit countries in Europe, namely Italy and Spain. That is, cases are increasing at a very quick rate now. We have over 50,000 infections and just over 5,000 deaths from the disease. Now, the daily pattern has varied somewhat in recent days. Over the weekend, the figures were quite worrying. There were close to 700 deaths each day reported across the country. In the last 2 days, that has decreased somewhat to around 500 or just below. But there are difficulties in comparing both days and different countries because of different testing regimes and different reporting methods. For example, here in the UK, the different nations that make up the United Kingdom, namely England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland, have different testing regimes. They report at different times, and the numbers we're getting are only hospital deaths as well. But we do know that some people are dying from this disease at home. Some people, especially in old people's in care homes, are also dying before they're taken to hospital. So it's likely that the true death toll is actually higher than we know. The hope is that we are approaching the peak in Britain, where the number of new infections and the number of deaths reaches its highest number before starting to decline. Now, we're seeing that pattern in Spain and in Italy, and perhaps in France as well, although they had a high death toll yesterday. And so that is cause for hope that these measures that are being taken to try to stop the spread of the disease may now be working. They've been in place for 2 weeks, which is just about the incubation period of the virus. And so the hope is across the country that the harsh measures that everyone is trying to adhere to may actually be having an effect.
You mentioned that British has become a kind of a surveillance society because of these measures, and some people ignoring them and fighting against them. And I know that having lived there, that the UK is very much a pub culture, and there are a lot of people not happy with the closure of pubs. And so maybe because that presents a community for them, but people are finding other ways to develop a community around them.
Exactly right. It is a very community-minded society in many ways. As you mentioned, the pub culture, they sort of form the focus point of many communities. So where I live, there are at least six pubs within 2 or 3 minutes distance. You've got to remember that many people, as in the United States and in many countries around the world, live on their own, and going to the pub or perhaps going to the shops or other social clubs is their only form of contact. And there's a great worry at the moment for those people who aren't getting out or who perhaps don't have family members who are checking up on them. And to all intents and purposes, they are stuck at home on their own, watching these very disturbing news headlines, seeing the Prime Minister himself in hospital. And these must be hugely disturbing times for anyone in that situation. But as we're all experiencing this in many ways around the world, we each have our own personal difficulties, whether they are to do with our family, whether they're to do with loneliness, whether there are financial worries, and of course, well beyond when the disease is eventually taken under control, those financial worries will come to the fore as well. You mentioned that most people are trying to adhere to the rules here in Britain, and by far the majority are, but that is very difficult when you have young children or you live alone. You want to go out. At the moment, the weather is very good in London. It's 20 degrees, it's sunny outside. It's the first warm weather we've seen really for 6 months. And there is a huge urge among the public to get outside. They're seeing the parks in London and other cities, those great green lungs as they're described, of the cities closed, and they're being told to go home. And that's, for the moment, people are reluctantly doing so, but it's difficult to say how much longer this lockdown can go on for. It's now 2.5 weeks. Can we manage a month, perhaps 2 months at a push? Whether this can go on for several more months, as some scientists say it must, in order to stop the spread of the coronavirus, it's very difficult to say.
And I think people, it sounds like people are taking this very seriously, particularly as I mentioned, the surveillance culture. You know, neighbors are telling on neighbors, are reporting their neighbors and other people who are not adhering to the social distancing or the self-isolation that has been mandated.
Exactly. So this is a society that has norms that have been in existence for hundreds of years. We don't have a written constitution. Generally operate by accepted norms and practices. Just as an example, most police in Britain, as you all well know, don't carry guns, unlike most police on the continent or in North America. And now to be confronted with this surveillance society of restricted movements, of governments checking up on what you are doing, is a huge shock to the psyche and the makeup of the society here. And it's really stretching those two different morals, really, if you like. One, the imperative to have that freedom, to be able to roam, to be able to go about your daily business without question, a huge underpinning pillar of British democracy, that is now curtailed. But there is the other urge to try to follow the rules, whether unwritten or explicit, that are being enforced by the government. So you do find these differing responses, even among those who you wouldn't have expected it from before. There are, you know, perhaps older generations who are very law-abiding people, and they find these restrictions very difficult to deal with. And they are going out more than once a day against the recommendations of the government. You find parents obviously struggling to deal with children locked in the house all day and with this good weather and not getting any exercise and so on. So, yes, myriad effects on British society, and the longer term implications of this, I think, for many societies, not just in Britain, from around the world, will be huge. Just to give you an idea of what I'm looking at the moment is the human rights aspects of all of these restrictions that are being laid on our societies around the world. And how long are those going to last for? In many countries, there are restrictions on public protests, public gatherings, and so on. Will it be easy for governments to lift those restrictions? The new technology that's coming in about mobile phone apps that track our movements, drones in the sky warning us against certain types of behavior. Will they be withdrawn when coronavirus is no longer a threat? These are questions that we'll have to deal with in the months and years ahead.
Indeed. Henry, and I want to ask you, we talked a little bit about, you know, people who don't have anyone to check up on them. And I'm curious about the homeless population, how they're being handled, because nobody's really talking about the homeless in this crisis.
Exactly right. And like you, several people have highlighted their vulnerability to this. If you're told to stay home, then you don't have a home. What do you do? The government has made it mandatory for local councils who are responsible for the homeless population in this country to try to find accommodation for the homeless population. The official homeless population is something numbering around the few thousand, but unofficially it's likely to be far higher. So for the moment, most councils are trying their best to find temporary accommodation, whether it be in hostels or bed and breakfast type accommodation, whether it's in larger sort of halls, community halls, sports centres that have been taken over. And money is being diverted towards this. But at a time when all public finances are now under huge strain, that's just another line in the accounts that has to be met as well. But again, there are questions, deeper questions about society. Then if we are now able to afford the money to house those homeless people, to look after them, why weren't we able to do so before? Yes. And so there are political questions that will have to be answered as well. For the moment, those political questions are on the back burner, and most people from across the spectrum are trying to pull together to beat the disease. But yes, you mentioned homeless people. There are migrant populations who are very transient. We don't really know where they are or where they are staying. For example, the huge fruit-picking migrant population comes to Britain, numbering in the several hundred thousands every year from Eastern Europe. They tend to stay in accommodation with up to 10, 15 people per room. How does that work with social distancing and staying at home and so on? And that industry itself is now in trouble because there aren't the people to pick the fruit and vegetables. So the effects, again, of coronavirus are going to go so deep into society, it's very difficult to predict.
Yes. Well, Henry Ridgwell, thank you so much for joining us. Be safe and stay healthy.
Thank you very much, Tonya. Yeah, well, all the best to you and to your audience as well. I hope to speak to you again.